We're going to hear next from Whitney Gray from the Department of Environmental Protection. And just a quick note that you'll see some of these cards on the table. So as you're listening to the speakers, if you have a question, you can write down the name of the speaker and the question, and then those will be funneled into the Q&A at the end of the day. Thanks.
Good morning. I am so excited to be here. This is an amazing turnout. I'm so happy to be here, and especially to have all the elected folks here that are here representing their communities. It's so encouraging. It's, as Colonel Dodd just said, you know, you are the leaders, and your communities really do look to you for that inspiration and for that leadership, and I just so appreciate that all of you are here at every level. I want to thank all the mayors for their presentations. Those were really helpful in setting the stage for what we're talking about. From the historic perspective Mayor Orvec's just absolutely gung-ho. I love that. I know you're excited about going to Hawaii, but thank you for that infectious enthusiasm. I appreciate it. Awesome. That's a good place to study it. What I really want to pound home today is actually what Chairwoman Bartz mentioned, which is we know how to do this. What I'm going to talk to you today about is how the state can help you with this. But it all boils down to a simple message. We know how to do this. I'll take you through a couple of examples. There's no rocket science here. This is all stuff we already know how to do. It's just about finding the tools that you need, bringing them all together, and getting it done. So, the first thing I want to talk about is, well, I'll do a little bit of background. And so when we talk about resilience planning, what we're talking about has a basis in statute in Florida. And later today, my dear friend Barbara Lenchevsky is going to tell you more about this peril of flood statute. And, you know, you can debate about how scary that name is. That was the actual name on the statute when it came out in 2015 was the peril of flood. And that sounds very dire, but I think it was named that way for a couple of reasons. And the main one was to drive home that we're not fooling around here, that the flooding that's happening around our state is a hazard. This isn't just inconvenient. It can really be a hazard, as I'm sure you're aware. So we need to take action on this. So the planning that we're going to talk about today really has its basis in statute. And so what we've tried to do at the state is to help communities comply with the requirements that they have in statute. And that's really what I'm here to talk about, is how my program has helped people do that. Have helped communities do that. So why are we interested in this? Why is this a big deal at all? Well, because that's an octopus, and it's in a parking garage. It's an octopus in a parking garage. There may be some confusion in your mind. I understand. This actually happened. This is a picture from the Miami Herald. This is happening. Coastal flooding from sea level rise and other sources is happening all over the state. How does this happen? How do we get an octopus in a freaking parking garage? Well, I want you to pay close attention to this little PowerPoint animation, because I worked really hard on this. I found a really good animation on a website that NOAA runs, but I couldn't figure out how to copy it and put it in my presentation, so I had to make it up. So I'm going to tell you now, explain to you, with apologies to all the stormwater engineers in the room, this is how you get an octopus in the parking garage. So the blue part is the water, and the black part, the black part here is a stormwater pipe. You can go back because you missed it. So our stormwater systems work on gravity, right? We pointed all of our stormwater drains downhill, but we made sure that they, wherever they let out, it was above the high tide line. Well, the problem that we're encountering is that the high tide line has shifted, right? And as the high tide line shifts, now watch that stormwater pipe, as the high tide line shifts, the salt water goes back up. The water finds its level, right? So it's going to go up those stormwater pipes to a varying degree, where depending on where it is. Well, when the stormwater pipe is already full of salt water, anything that falls, oh, look at that, in the form of rain, can't drain out. And so what happens is the streets fill up with water, or the parking garages, or whatever. Wasn't that amazing? I think I deserve a round of applause. So we're trying to figure out how to, that's how you get an octopus in the parking garage. Now let's figure out what we do about that. So we know that we can adapt to these changing situations. And we know that besides the benefit of just not having octopi in parking garages, there are other benefits to adaptation. And we have such a coastally dependent economy in this state that we know that this has benefits that hit our bottom line. So we know that all these different industries are key to Florida, and when we have changing conditions, salt water in the streets, upsetting our recreation and our tourism and all those kinds of things, it's disruptive. We have more impact from storms. That's the Ponte Vedra shoreline after Hurricane Matthew. We know that when we adapt to those conditions, we have lesser impacts. We know that the, as soon as I get up here, I forget the acronyms. The flood insurance, what is it, Barbara? NFIP, right, and the community CRS rating system. Thank you. See? Community rating system helps us, because when we take those community-wide activities to reduce our flood risk, the cost for flood insurance goes down for everyone. And we also know that there are larger organizations that impact our local communities looking at this. And we know that bond ratings for our publicly financed projects are starting to be looked at in terms of what are you planning for. Agencies like Moody's and others are starting to pay attention to what we've done, so that they can assess how good a risk their investment in your debt is. So it's important that we pay attention to this and that we take some action on it. Here's a great example. Here's Mexico Beach. Here's the famous picture from the New York Times, the doctor's house. And while this isn't the only house that stayed standing, the lesson here is that this guy adapted. He didn't have to. You know, he didn't build this house when the hurricane warnings were on. He built this house several years ago when he didn't think he had to. But he knew that if he took certain steps to prepare, it would pay off in the future. So he elevated it higher than it had to be. And he put pilings down deeper than they had to be. He built above the code. He built for higher winds than he had to. All of those things. He did more than he needed to because he was looking out to the future and he wanted to mitigate those risks. We can do those kinds of things as a community. And we also know that when we take those steps, it's been studied and shown that there is a positive return on investment. From anywhere from, I think the hurricane surge return on investment is 7 to 1. So for every dollar that we put into building over and above our building codes, we get a 7-fold return on that investment in avoided costs. That's huge. It pays to adapt. So the program that I am here to represent, which sits in the Department of Environmental Protection, is called the Florida Resilient Coastlines Program. And we were devised about 18, 19 months ago to try and help communities deal with these issues that are happening to them, to try and bring our knowledge and our resources to the local communities, because all over the state, communities like yours are dealing with these issues. And we do that with three basic ways. We have resources, like our Florida Adaptation Planning Guidebook, which I'm going to talk about, and technical assistance in the form of an actual staff person who can come to you and sit with you and teach you how to use some of the really cool whiz-bang sea level rise visualization tools that are online. We also have funding. I said, funding. Money for planning and for implementation. And I'll talk about that some more too. And coordination. And I have found that even though the first two, as I think it was Mayor Hudson said, are not that sexy, the first two are very sexy. The third one is my favorite because that's where we have communities talking together over a huge statewide network. So first, the Adaptation Planning Guidebook. This is an amazing resource, and I have to credit my friend Barbara here because starting back around 2011 or so, the DEP got some funding from NOAA and contracted with the Department of Economic Opportunity to do some research on what are the best practices for adaptation planning in Florida specifically. And over a number of years, many people, including Barbara, contributed to those best practices, which we then compiled into this handy dandy guidebook. And I have brought several copies that I can distribute. These are some of the topics in the guidebook. And what's really interesting about these topics is they take you through a process of identifying your vulnerabilities and then figuring out how to adapt to them. And I also want to mention the photograph over there on the right hand of the slide. This is a really interesting photograph, and it's one of those examples that I have of what communities are dealing with. So this feature right here, that's a well. That's an old, old well. And this is on an island near the Guanatalamato Matanzas National Estuarine Research Reserve, just a bit north of here near Pontevedra. And this is back on an island, in a river on an island. And that well used to be in the middle of the island. And now it's on the edge. And the folks in the community are trying to figure out, because there used to be a small little village or something on that island, they're trying to figure out what to do about that well, because it's a cultural resource. And so they're trying to determine whether they should leave it as a sunken archaeological thing, or take it apart and put it back together in a museum. So that's one of the kinds of challenges that are facing people all over the state. And we try to provide some guidance on how to go through a process where everybody can figure out together what to do with things like that. So here's the process that we try and get folks to go through. It starts with determining the context of your planning. So if you're going to embark on this adventure, determining the context is really important. You might decide that you want to come up with a plan for the entirety of St. Lucie County. You might decide that you only want to figure out a plan for Port St. Lucie or some other part of your community. Maybe it's just the historic district of one of the cities. So establishing that context first is really important. How much do you want to bite off? And then the second step is vulnerability assessment. That's figuring out your vulnerability, and that is your vulnerability, basically what we're talking about, to sea level rise, storm surge, those kinds of issues, problems. And you do that by figuring out how exposed your assets are, how sensitive they are to the impacts, and how much they can be adapted. For example, if you look a little farther north, the fort at St. Augustine doesn't have a lot of adaptive capacity. You cannot put that on a trailer and move it uphill. It's got to be right there. So you go through a process where you figure out all those vulnerabilities. Then you go through adaptation strategies to determine what to do about those vulnerabilities. Then you prioritize them and start figuring out how to implement them. It sounds really easy, doesn't it? So just to walk you through a couple of the steps, again, here are, you know, thinking about the overarching goals of what you're going to do in your plan. It could be, these are examples from a plan from the East Central Florida Regional Planning Council. And they came up for Brevard and Volusia counties. And these are the big buckets of issues that they determined to work on. And they make sure the guidebook recommends putting in public outreach at lots of different points, because you can't do this in a vacuum. You can't do it completely from a top-down thing. You've got to have public input on these things. The guidebook actually gives you some very good direction on how to do several different kinds of public outreach. You have to figure out things like your adaptive capacity. How much can your system adapt to climate change or sea level rise and all the different damages? And what sort of capability and capacity do you have? Where are the areas where you really need help? Like, we might have a lot of cash to do this with, but we don't have a lot of staff, or vice versa. And then you start thinking about what types of adaptation strategies you want to use. And this is where I go back to, we know how to do this, because some of the adaptation strategies are as easy as, you know, a little bitty sort of like a rain garden, a mini rain garden on a curb to keep water flowing to the right direction down the storm drain instead of flooding the sidewalk. Adaptation strategies can be protective, where they really keep, they're made to keep water out, completely out of a place. They can be accommodating, where like, you know, you're gonna have flooding, so your first floor is kind of parking, but if the water gets bad, it's okay if the parking garage gets flooded. That's kind of an accommodation. They can be retreat, which is you just decide that this is not a feasible place for this thing to be anymore. And then they can be avoidance, which is things like, all right, we're gonna proactively say this is not a good place to do things. And so there are lots of different ways you can have those strategies play out, and different depending on how big the risk is and how much you wanna invest in those places. Adaptation action areas are a good tool as well. And my other friend Nancy Gassman is here, and I bet she might talk a little bit about adaptation action areas. That's a comprehensive planning tool for designating an area where you want to concentrate your activities and resources and funding. And of course, at the end of all of that analysis, you prioritize your adaptation needs, and then you start figuring out who is winning, who, not winning, but, you know, is the stormwater needs more important than the road needs? Or, you know, you have to prioritize, and that's just a funny picture about, like, competition between city departments. We have grants, as I said, to help you along the way. Our next round of funding will be started, applications will open on August 1st. And these are the priorities that we will be focusing on for this, the next round of funding. And I will say that next round of funding is for fiscal year 2020 to 2021. And the information for that is on my website, which is on my last slide. Here are some examples, just glancing quickly at some examples of past projects. And over the past 18 months or so, we've given out over 30 projects, about $2.2 million. These are some of the implementation projects where we're actually building stuff, and this is in Sarasota, and we did a living shoreline along here, and that's this project, and we just recently opened it. There wasn't a ribbon, but we sort of virtually cut a ribbon. Last thing really quick, I know I'm gonna go over, but one of our projects is in the city of Hollywood, and where they have a marina right here. And the marina, they realized, was the source of a lot of saltwater flooding in the neighborhood right here. And I got some video to show you, just to show you what some of your neighbors are going through. You all know your own story, but this is the boat ramp at the marina at Hollywood. And this is a king tide. And it's kind of weird, like that octopus in the parking garage. This is water flowing uphill and across this parking lot and down the street. Now, note those lawns, those yards right there, because later in the same event, you'll see what it wound up looking like. And our project with Hollywood is to elevate that whole parking area and boat ramp. That's salt water going right up in people's yards and stuff. So this is an issue, and this is happening at places all over the state. Here's my coordination list. These are some of the cities and counties, state agencies, federal agencies, universities, nonprofits, and consultants that get with us on a call every quarter to talk about what's going on in their areas and to help each other across the table solve problems. You can drop me an email and I can put you on the list. And our website is easy to remember, floridadep.gov/resilience, where you can find information on all the things that I just talked about. And I also want to give a note that August 8th and 9th in Tampa, some of you may have gotten an invitation to a workshop that we're going to be hosting that's going to go through a lot of these concepts in greater detail. 2 days, solidly jam-packed. Let me know if you did not receive an invitation and would like one. And finally, at your fingertips, you have great resources. I want to give a shout out to my colleagues from the Indian River Lagoon Aquatic Preserve, Irene and Emily and Kirk are right over here. They would love to be involved in this. I know I'm speaking for them, but they would love to be involved with this. Also the NEP, IRL NEP is a very good resource. So please take advantage of your natural resource partners. Thank you for your tolerance in going over.